أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم ما بعد رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفع بما علمتنا وزدنا علما السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. My dear respected brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, we always begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, sustainer, nourisher and provider. And we thank Allah azza wa jal for all the bounties that He has given us. Allah ta'ala says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا, that if we were to count the bounties of Allah, wallahi we will never be able to do so. We thank Allah azza wa jal for granting us the greatest bounty, and that is the bounty of Iman. The bounty of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. And we pray to Allah Azza wa Jal with utmost sincerity that Ya Allah, keep us firm on this deen. Allahumma thabbitna ala al-Iman, wa amitna ala al-Iman, wa ahshurna yawm al-qiyamati ma'a al-Iman. Oh Allah, keep us firm on Iman. Allow us to die with Iman and resurrect us on the day of Qiyamah with Iman. And also we make another dua that Ya Allah, keep my progeny on Islam. We send abundant salutations upon our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he enters the masjid on one occasion and he sees the companions study. So the Prophet of Allah said to the companions, ماذا تذكرون? What are you studying? So the Sahaba, they replied to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, نتذكر الساعة يا رسول الله. They mentioned that we are speaking about matters relating to the hour. So the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he replied to them saying, وَمَا أَمْرُ السَّاعَةِ إِلَّا كَلَمْحِ الْبَصَرِ أَوْ هُوَ أَقْرَبُ, that the matter of the hour is like the blinking of an eye, or even closer than that, subhanAllah. Then the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned certain minor signs that will occur. And there are many, many minor signs. For example, the Prophet of Allah says, hadith comes in Muslim, إِنَّ مِنْ أَشْرَاطِ السَّاعَةِ أَن يُرْفَعَ الْعِلْمِ وَيَثْبُتَ الْجَهْلِ, that indeed of the signs of the hour is that knowledge will be lifted and ignorance will prevail. وَيَظْهَرَ الزِّنَا, zina will become very common, fornication, and even drinking of khamr. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to protect us, and there are many, 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 many other signs. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he categorized these signs that will determine the coming of the hour, he determined the signs of Judgment Day in two, as two. Right? The Isharatu Sughra wa Isharatu Kubra, the minor signs and the major signs. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he mentioned some of the major signs, he mentioned the black smoke, three major earthquakes, the coming of Isa alayhi salam, Nuzul Isa alayhi salam, and of course the Dajjal, and so on. However, there is a sign that enters from the minor signs to the major signs, and that is the coming of the Al-Mahdi, the Mahdi. And inshallah ta'ala, in this short lecture, we are going to speak about the Mahdi. Now, before we touch on the topic, it is very sad to actually make mention of that there are many people, Muslims, that deny the Mahdi. They deny the concept of Dajjal. They deny the concept of Isa alayhi salam coming back. They don't even believe in this concept of Mahdi, and it's a problem. It's a big problem. Why? Because if you are to basically not believe in the Mahdi, in the coming back of Isa alayhi salam, you are actually saying that you do not believe the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you do not believe in these signs, these major signs that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has spoken about. So this is part of our aqidah, our belief, that we believe in these signs because sadaqa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it came from our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet of Allah, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُّ يُوحَىٰ. The Prophet of Allah, he did not speak from his whims and fancies. Whatever he spoke, it was revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Mahdi, the Al-Mahdi is a minor sign, but however, when the Mahdi will come, this is the beginning of the major sign. So as soon as the Mahdi is the minor sign that will enter us into the major signs. So, what is the Mahdi? A lot of people say Imam Mahdi. And it's not Imam Mahdi. The word Mahdi is derived from the word Huda or Hada, which means guidance. Which means guidance. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we hear in the Quran, Ihdina, to guide. Allah, we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our salah, we say Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, guide us to the straight path. The word Mahdi does not appear in the Quran. However, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he utilized this word where he said, follow the khulafa al-rashideen, al-mahdiyin. Follow the rightly guided khalifas of Islam, the rightly guided ones. So the word mahdiyin means rightly guided. So what is the name? So the word Mahdi is the title that is given to this person. Are you with me? It is not Imam Mahdi, it is the Mahdi, the guider. So what is his name? If it is not Imam Mahdi, then what is the name of the Imam? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, hadith comes in Abu Dawood, that if there was only one day left on this earth, if there was only one day left on this earth, Allah Azza wa Jal would extend this day until there would come a man whose name will be my name and his father's name will be my father's name. And he will prevail justice on this earth. So let's analyze this hadith. Firstly, why did Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that if there was one day left on this dunya, Allah Azza wa Jal, he would extend this day? Why? Who can tell me? Why did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam make mention of this statement? Why did he choose the words, if there was one day left on this dunya, Allah Azza wa Jal would extend this day to receive this one man? Why? Right, so it is to show the importance of the coming of the Mahdi. It is to emphasize the importance of the Mahdi coming. So the Prophet of Allah said, his name will be my name. So his name will be Muhammad. And his father's name, meaning the Mahdi, the chosen person by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his father's name will be my father's name, meaning the father of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is Abdullah. So the name of the Mahdi will be Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Are you all with me? This hadith comes in Abu Dawood. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, his name will be my name, and his father's name will be my father's name, and the Mahdi will come from my tribe. Meaning, yani, he will be from the Quraysh. And to take it a step further, the Mahdi will come from the Ahlul Bayt, from the lineage of Fatima radiyallahu anha. Now Ali radiyallahu anhu and Fatima radiyallahu anha, they had two children. Who are they? Al-Hasan and Hussein. So this is what we call the Ahlul Bayt, from the lineage of Fatima radiyallahu anha. So we believe the Mahdi will come through the lineage of the Ahlul Bayt. Now the question arises, will the Mahdi, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, will he come from the lineage of Imam Hassan radiyallahu anhu, or will he come from Imam Hussein radiyallahu anhu? And according to the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we say that the Mahdi will come through the lineage of Imam Hassan. The Shia say that the Mahdi will come from Imam Hussein. And we back this up with the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One narration, Ali radiallahu anhu, he mentions, while holding his child, Hassan, he says, إِنَّ بَنِي هَذَا هُوَ سَيِّد, that this child of mine, he is a leader. He is a leader, subhanallah. Now, of course, the Shias are not happy with this, that Imam Hassan, we believe that the Mahdi will come through his lineage. And the reason for that is that they were not happy. And we need to understand and take a step further that how Shiism came about, it all began firstly as a political party. And then their theology changed as well. But it began as a political party, subhanAllah. And they were not happy that Imam Hassan gave up his khilafah. But Imam Hassan, he gave up his khilafah for a reason. Why? Because he felt that there was enough blood being shed and he wanted to prevail justice and peace. And he did this for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the hadith of the Prophet of Allah. Now bear in mind, when you talk about the Mahdi, there are many fabricated hadith as well. Many hadith. But many of them, unfortunately, many people quote the weak ahadith. But inshallah, in today's lecture, you will only hear the authentic ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now what is our evidence to prove that the Mahdi will come from the lineage of Imam Hassan? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on one occasion, he is delivering the khutbah. And Hassan, he is only, some scholars say that between the ages of 2 and 4. And he is walking in the masjid. And he is wearing a very long thobe. You know, picture a little boy coming into the masjid and his thobe is extremely long. So what's going to happen? When he walks, he trips over. So while he trips over, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the minbar, he stops the khutbah. When he sees Hassan radiallahu anhu, a little baby, he trips over and he starts crying. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he comes down from the minbar. Imagine. And then he takes hold of Hassan radiallahu anhu, and then he climbs back onto the minbar and he says, this child of mine, yani his grandson, he is a sayyid, he is a leader. And it is through his lineage that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring about a person. And this person will prevail justice throughout the lands at a time of corruption. Subhanallah. So this is the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, again referring to the lineage of Imam Hassan radiyallahu anhu. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, he makes mention of a very amazing thing. He says, subhanallah, this is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that even though Imam Hassan, he gave up his khilafah for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal is honoring him by choosing his lineage for such an honorable person, one of the khalifas of the Muslimin that will come in the future, to be chosen from the lineage of Imam Hassan radiyallahu anhu. Subhanallah, this is the hikmah, this is the wisdom behind all of this, subhanAllah. Allah Azza wa Jal is elevating the status of Imam Hassan. And please bear in mind, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, we love them both. They are our companions. We have utmost respect and love for both. They are the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum ajma'een. So now we have discussed the name. We have discussed the description of where this person will come about. Now the question is, how does he look like? What would be the features of the Mahdi? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions that they will come. Hadith comes in Abu Dawood. There are many ahadith. Most of the authentic hadith relating to the Mahdi is mentioned in Abu Dawood, one of the Sahih Sittah. So the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that there will come a time, there will come a person whose name will be my name. He will have my qualities, but he will not resemble me in features. The Mahdi will have the akhlaq, the approach, the exact akhlaq and approach of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but his features will be different. And the hadith mentions that the Mahdi, he will have a very long forehead and an alkaline nose. Now amongst the Arabs, to have that long nose, it is a form of beauty. An alkaline nose. So in terms of features, he will not look like anything like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He will have a long forehead and he will have an alkaline nose. There is no other description, authentic description, that is mentioned regarding how the Mahdi Muhammad ibn Abdullah will look. So this is how you look like. Regarding the spirituality of the Mahdi, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions, now what are the criteria to be the Mahdi? Number one, your name has to be Muhammad, and your father's name has to be
Abdullah,
and you need to be from the Quraysh, from the family of the Ahlul Bayt, and you need to have these features. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made mention, hadith comes in Ibn Majah, that the person whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will choose to be the Mahdi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will rectify him and make his islah in one night. So what does this mean? This is a very important point. So the Mahdi will be a normal person. He will not know himself that he is appointed as the Mahdi. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will rectify, prepare him. How that will happen, that is only known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So meaning, in one night he will become the most pious person on earth. He will be the most knowledgeable person, the most pious person on earth, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes islah, rectifies him in one night. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala, when he interprets this hadith, he says that on this night, this man will make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his sins. So imagine, the Mahdi is something you cannot plan. It is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This khilafah, this appointment of the Mahdi, is something that is appointed by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Now a lot of people give predictions. They say, the Mahdi will come according to hadith, he will come in 2020. Have you ever heard of people making these predictions? And wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, anyone who gives any prediction, they are a liar. Because no one has the ability to know what will happen tomorrow. No one can make this prediction that the Mahdi will come at a particular time. No. The only evidence we have is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. So regarding the timing, we don't know. But yes, the other question that is posed, where will he come from? Now again, there are differences of opinion on where the Mahdi will come from. And there are many, again, fabricated hadith regarding where he will come from. To make it easy for you to understand, there are two sets of hadith. There is one narration which comes in At-Tirmidhi, where he mentions the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions that the Mahdi will come from Khurasan. From Khurasan. East Khurasan, which refers to Afghanistan or close to Iran. This is one opinion. However, with this hadith which comes in Tirmidhi, there is a slight weakness in it. It is not a fabricated hadith. It is not on the level of what we call in hadith terms shadidul da'af, where it has a very severe, it is what we call a weak hadith. Now, weak hadith, we don't throw out the door, because there are other hadith to back it up. However, what we need to understand, there could be a 50-50 chance. Fabricated hadith, we throw out the door. But if it's a weak hadith, we can still accept it, but we cannot derive absolute verdicts from the hadith. This is one opinion. So, once again, to make it very clear, we don't throw these hadith out the door. It's very important to understand. There are certain levels of weakness that we still do accept as an opinion. And there is a stronger opinion, which comes in Abu Dawood, where the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions that the Mahdi will come from Medina. And this is more authentic. So when the Mahdi will be appointed, and he will be in Medina, and then he will migrate to Mecca. And of course, knowing that Allah Azza wa Jal has chosen you, the Mahdi at that point will be very scared. He will be very scared. And people would actually have to force him out of his home to come to the Kaaba. Why is the Mahdi? Why is Muhammad ibn Abdullah? Why is he so scared? Who can tell me? Who can reason in their mind? Why would Muhammad ibn Abdullah, who has been granted this power, granted this status from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he is scared? Why? Because people may not believe him, and also the responsibility. This is the true Mahdi, because there are many people who claim to be the Mahdi in the past, but they wanted the leadership. If someone wants to be a leader, they should not be a leader. Leadership is chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, he will be taken to the Rukun al-Yaman. He will stand between the Hajr al-Aswad and the Maqam Ibrahim. And the announcement will be made. And of course, what we need to remember, that the coming of the Mahdi will be the greatest threat to those in authority at that time, who will be controlling Makkatul Mukarrama and Madinatul Munawwara. You can imagine, subhanAllah, what will happen. So now Muhammad ibn Abdullah, he will be at that actual point, and people will come and pledge allegiance to him. Civil war will break loose. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions, he says, I saw in a dream a group of people, hadith comes in Bukhari and Muslim, a group of people that will attack the Kaaba. They will attack the Kaaba, and they will reside by a city called Al-Bayda. Bayda is a city very close to the Kaaba Sharif. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the people that will be working for the people who are in authority, because there will be civil war. Now the Mahdi is a threat, because this is the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Mahdi will come at a time of fitna and fasad. The Muslim Ummah will be going through so much hardship. The Muslim Ummah will go through so much pain and suffering. A lot of what we are seeing today, subhanAllah, may Allah Azza wa Jal protect us. Because it is a time of fitna. SubhanAllah, you can imagine, the Muslim Ummah from every corner will be suffering. They will be going through so much hardship, and this is when the Mahdi will come. Civil war will break loose. This army will plan to attack the Kaaba, to attack the Mahdi. But what will happen? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hadith comes in Bukhari and Muslim, will cause the earth to swallow this entire army, subhanAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause the earth to swallow this entire army. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she posed a very important question, subhanAllah. Because the question, the doubt that is in our mind, the concern, is what will happen to those people? Because there is no doubt that within that army, there are genuine people. They are forced, they have no choice, they have to listen and obey. It's a very, very difficult task. So imagine, look at the hikmah, look at the wisdom of this hadith, where Aisha radiallahu anha, she posed a very important question to clear up this problem, or this bad thought that we may have in our heart. Because in our heart, if Aisha radiallahu anha did not mention that, we would have thought that every single person that got swallowed, his abode will be in Jahannam. But no. When Aisha radiallahu anha posed this question, that what would be the decree of those people who were sincere, whose intention was not to attack the Kaaba, but they were forced to do so, what will be their final goal? What will be their destination? So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied to Aisha radiallahu anha, stating that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge every single person according to his intention, subhanAllah. So that removes that concern, that every person that will be part of that army, they are not bad people. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. So now the Mahdi will be in power. People will pledge allegiance to him. This time will be the best time for the Muslimin. When the Mahdi will come, he will come at a time where there will be so much disunity amongst the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like we see today, unfortunately. I am from this group, you are from that group, this one. I don't go to that masjid because of this and because of that. So much disunity amongst the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is so sad. May Allah unite our hearts. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that when the Mahdi will come, he will not be the Khalifa of one group of people, no. The Mahdi will be the Khalifa of all the Muslims around the world. And the Mahdi will unite the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How beautiful will that be? Allahu Akbar. The Mahdi, he will unite all the people. After all of this disunity, the Mahdi will bring all the Muslims back together as that one Ummah, like how it should be. Inna hadhihi ummatukum ummatan wahida. So in the Khilafah of the Mahdi, how long will he serve as a leader? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, يَمْلِكُ سَبْعَ سِنِينَ. He will serve as the leader for 7 years. And this 7 years will be the best 7 years for the Muslims. For everyone, subhanallah. It will be a time of justice. Because the Mahdi, one of his sole objectives is to prevail justice on the dunya. There will be a lots of wealth. There will be so much barakah and khair. However, towards the ending of the 7 years will come the next major sign, and that is the Dajjal. The Dajjal. And when the Dajjal will come, civil war will break loose again. And the Mahdi will fight with the Dajjal. However, he will not be the one to kill the Dajjal. Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes in Bukhari and Muslim. And this is now the next phase. This is a basic understanding of the coming of the Mahdi. See how the existence of the Mahdi, he is the entering into the major signs. When the major signs come, that is when the day of Qiyamah will be established thereafter, inshallah. However, when the Dajjal will come, this will be the greatest fitna on this dunya. And we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from experiencing or being alive at that time. A lot of people say, I can't wait until Dajjal comes. Astaghfirullah. What are you talking about, man? What's wrong with you? Right? You don't make dua to be there because this is the greatest fitna. This is the greatest fitna that a person will encounter on this dunya. Never make dua to be there. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are not alive at that time. Because the fitna is too great. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, hadith comes in Bukhari and Muslim. It will be Salatul Fajr in Damascus. Also narrations mention that this will take place when Isa alayhi salam will come down. And this will be in Damascus. Some ulama mentioned that it will be in Masjid Umawi. And it will be the time for Salatul Fajr. And just before, while the Iqamah is being made, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down Isa alayhi salam with two malaika. Allah. Imagine, subhanallah, the Dajjal. They are fighting the Dajjal. After 7 years of prosperity, of happiness and justice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down at the time of Salatul Fajr. When the Iqamah is being made, Isa alayhi salam will come down. Allahu Akbar. And at that point, the Mahdi, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, he will offer Isa alayhi salam to lead the prayers. And he will refuse and say, no, the Iqamah has been made, so you lead the Salah. So the Mahdi will lead the prayer. Now, from this point onwards, there is no mention of the Mahdi. From this point onwards, there is no mention of the Mahdi. But what we know is when Isa alayhi salam will come, the Khilafah and the leadership will be given to Isa alayhi salam. And he will be the one to kill the Dajjal. Subhanallah. So as you can see, the Mahdi is a minor sign of Qiyamah that will enter us into the major signs, the Dajjal and the coming of Isa alayhi salam. My dear respected brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, we are Muslim. And it is important for us to understand our deen. It is important for us to understand this knowledge. There are a lot of Muslims who don't know about the concept of Dajjal. They don't know the concept of Isa alayhi salam. They don't know about the Mahdi. So inshallah ta'ala, we make dua to Allah azza wa jal that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in beneficial knowledge. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those people who prepare for our meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For each and every one of us, we have to leave this world. And we need to leave behind that legacy. The legacy of what? The legacy of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.